Chernobyl Sarcophagus, the ultimate structure designed to isolate the destroyed nuclear reactor. Every element of its construction is a story of creativity, risk, and heroism. Today we will take a detailed look at how it was built and the parts that make it up. We will also uncover some of its hidden secrets, like the reason why an entire train was entombed inside. This is a story of what may be the most complex structure humanity has ever built. Much has been said about radiation, surveys, and cleanup efforts at this site. But to understand the design of the sarcophagus, we need to look at how the Chernobyl nuclear power plant was originally built. So, the main structure is nearly 816 meters or nearly 2700 feet long. It has a shared turbine hall and aerator stack raising between it and reactor buildings. It was built in two phases different in design, so units 1 and 2 were separate, while units 3 and 4 mirrored each other, sharing system housed in so-called Block V, including ventilation and the iconic chimney. Now, an important detail which we'll use in our explanation next. So, there are no floors, and instead there are levels, because the size and height of holes varies greatly. And if you look, say, at Unit 4 from the top, there are defined axles marked with numbers, and rows marked with Cyrillic letters. This system made navigation easier, and we'll refer to it as well. The foundation and the part near the reactor were made of monolithic reinforced concrete. But above level plus 12.5 meters, all was mostly built with prefabricated panels on concrete and metal frames. This was different from phase 1, which was mostly monolithic, and this contributed to the collapse after the explosion. The explosion was so powerful that the reactor hull basically became a crater, with debris piled high all around. The deaerator stack's upper section was also displaced, and fire warped the metal frames of the turbine hull. Additionally, in 2 weeks following the events, helicopters dropped over 14,000 tons of solid materials onto the ruins in an attempt to seal the burning reactor. So eventually, much of the site literally became inaccessible, leading to one critical question: what to do next? The solution was anything but straightforward, and the first ideas were vastly different from what was eventually built. On May 10, 1986, the operative group of the Politburo issued a secret order marking the first mention of burying Reactor 4. And over the next months, a massive organizational effort mobilized various Soviet ministries, authorities, and industrial sectors to tackle this problem. Following that, on May 20, the Ministry of Middle Machine Building formalized the effort with Order 211. It defined a design team led by Professor Vladimir Kurnosov, and established the Department of Construction 605, which managed the site and construction works. Kurnosov's team considered 18 proposals, each attempting to balance feasibility, speed, and safety. For example, one idea proposed burying Reactor 4 under a hill of soil, but it would have sacrificed Reactor 3 and also risked internal collapses. Another idea, called the monolith, aimed to encase the reactor in concrete, but filling the internal spaces entirely was actually nearly impossible. And moreover, the weight would have exceeded the foundation's capacity because the power plant stands on the sands. There were other ideas which included large domes and also console-like roofs, but the most promising was the arch. That had to be a sliding structure with 230 meter or 750 feet span, similar to the new safe confinement which was built decades later. Unfortunately, in 1986, the arch was still unfeasible. It required years to complete and exceeded the technological limits of that time. Finally, on May 28, just 8 days after the start, a clear vision emerged, and it was codenamed the Shelter Object. This would later become the official name of the Chernobyl sarcophagus. The plan was simple, yet bold. First, barriers would be constructed around to allow closer access. Then, the surviving and damaged structures of Reactor Unit 4 would serve as supports for new elements. Some holes would also act as shields for concrete separation walls, dividing and containing the radioactive remains. This approach drastically shortened the construction timeline to just a few months by using large prefabricated metal components. And most importantly, it ensured the destroyed reactor remained under control. On May 31, a technical task was approved, setting a completion deadline for September 1986. Kronosov's team collaborated with multiple project institutes, working intensively to design each element of what would later become the sarcophagus. Preparing the site for construction was truly a monumental task. One of the key priorities was clearing radioactive debris from the roofs, and while some of this was done with robotics and remote tools, the majority relied on manpower. But the cleanup wasn't limited to the roofs. Nearly the entire power plant site was cleared of obstacles and covered with concrete panels. This not only reduced contamination, but also provided a stable foundation and operation space for the most critical tools of the construction, the DEMAG super cranes. Three of these massive cranes, supplied by West Germany, began arriving to the zone on June 15. Two of the cranes were equipped with additional counterweights, known as super lifts, to enhance their stability during heavy operations. However, deploying these machines was not a small feat. Each crane was so massive that transporting its disassembled parts required over 30 railway platforms. Additionally, once on site, they had to be outfitted with radiation protection and CCTV systems for remote control. All this setup process took over a month, delaying the main construction works until mid-August. But despite the setbacks, as you will see, the cranes made their job. Before the cranes were operational, the main focus was on separating units 3 and 4, and truly, this was a task of immense scale and complexity. Because thousands of pipes, cables, and connections had to be cut and then reconnected, often in areas with high radiation levels. Inside, an entire system of separation walls was constructed. These walls varied in design and thickness depending on their purpose and location, but averaged 1 meter or 3 feet thick. If you ever visited the Chernobyl nuclear power plant, you actually have likely passed by one of these walls. The one near the memorial dedicated to Valery Khodemchuk. And before the new safe confinement was built and this wall was reconstructed, the concrete still bore imprints of corridors and severed pipes. In total, over 11,000 cubic meters of concrete went in these walls, yet this was only a fraction of what came next. In July, work began on two isolation contours designed to serve as foundations for cranes and to entomb high radioactive debris under concrete. The first step was constructing the so-called pioneer walls, standing 5 to 8 meters or 16 to 25 feet tall. These walls would contain the concrete poured behind them and act as first radiation shield for construction workers. But how do you build such structures when exposure time is so limited? The solution was as unusual as it was effective. So imagine, there was prepared a train made of railway platforms, each carrying cage-like metal boxes made of rebars, connected by rubber tubes. The train was pushed along the technological railway line near the turbine hole. And once positioned, concrete was pumped through these tubes, encasing the entire train and transforming it into a wall. At row U, on the north side, truck trailers moved those boxes in position. For added stability, once positioned, their wheels were shot from a distance before being encased in concrete. And before the final concreting, the space behind the walls encased approximately 90,000 cubic meters of contaminated soil, construction debris, and waste containers. With preparations complete, the main construction began, demanding an enormous supply of concrete. So to meet this need, three new factories were set up far from the power plant, safely away from high radiation levels. And not so far from the power plant, between Kopachi village and the Red Forest, lies a forgotten relic of that era. At this reloading unit, trucks came atop delivering concrete, then it was transferred to mixers operating next to the power plant. This method helped protect machinery and minimize the spread of radioactive contamination by car wheels. The next challenge was a massive pile of debris covering the remains of the northern circulation pump's hull. It was so large that objectively removing it was not an option. So engineers devised the northern cascade wall, a structure of three levels designed to contain the debris. Special outer segments, each up to 54 meters or 177 feet long, were transported to the site and positioned using DEMAG cranes. The wall became a massive burial ground for collected materials and, by some memories, even including contaminated vehicles. When additional lime was needed, there were added sections of tower cranes wrapped in chain-link mesh. To pour concrete into the wall, they used advanced Putzmeister mobile pumps provided by Germany. Yeah, Soviet Union had similar technology, but German pumps had higher performance and longer booms, which was a critical advantage. The thing is, each completed level served as a platform for the next, enabling the concrete pumps to deliver materials continuously to higher levels. So for this, they were arranged in a relay. At the top of the cascade wall was installed the northern counterforce wall. Like other elements, it was assembled from hollow segments which were filled with concrete only after positioning. The next step was to restore the roof over the reactor. This required installing supports to hold massive beams, including the main beam, known as the plane. The plane consisted of two beams, each 40 meters or 130 feet long, secured 25 meters or 82 feet apart with a pipe system. So, together with the straps, it weighed incredible 177 tons. And that's why its installation nearly ended in a new disaster. Helen Kozlova, who you may recall from our previous episode about Project Blotter, shared this memory from a colleague in her book. So they brought in the plane, set it in a pre-assembly position, secured it and started lifting. Everything went well until we began lowering the boom. Suddenly, we heard a cracking sound. The rear wheels of the superlift lifted off the ground and this 400-ton machine began to sway in the air. At the same time, the crane, its load and the boom were also swaying. The left rack stayed in place, but the whole thing kept rocking, we just stood there wondering, will it fall or not? Eventually, as a quick solution, a 40-ton container loaded with lead was placed atop of the superlift, stabilizing the DEMAG crane and allowing the plane to land in its position. Afterward, two additional beams were installed alongside the plane. And together, these beams supported the roof, which is based on 27 large pipes. Each 120 centimeters or 4 feet in diameter. Why so massive? Because initially it was planned to pour over around 20 inches of concrete atop, but eventually the plan changed and instead it was covered with lightweight metal panels. Additionally, a cover known as the doghouse was built between the roof and block V, completing this section of the structure. On the southern side, a thick wall was built between the deaerator stack and the turbine hull. Then, nearly 17,000 cubic meters of concrete were poured into space between the deaerator stack and the reactor unit. This wall served as a foundation for the gigantic beam called the Octopus, positioned in the row B. Then, in the row V was installed even larger beam, which was named the Mammoth. Measuring 75 meters or 250 feet long and weighing 127 tons, the Mammoth was positioned on special supports. Together with Octopus, it provided a base for so-called southern hockey sticks. Those were L-shaped installations that covered the ruins of the deaerator stack. Similar, small hockey stick installations were used to fill the gap between the cascade wall and beam B1. However, on the southern side, the gap between Mammoth and beam B2 was too large, so it was closed using 12 massive southern panels. Finally, one of the most iconic features of the sarcophagus was added. It's called a western counterforce wall. Like the northern wall, it was constructed using hollow sections. However, the western wall was positioned on a robust concrete foundation and does not touch the building itself. While the sections were designed to be filled with concrete for additional stability, this step was never completed. You know, I will tell you something. Me and my wife Michaela have been right next to this wall multiple times. And honestly, we still cannot even explain how huge that wall actually is. You know, it feels simply gigantic. The metal installation that now stands in front of it is a special stabilization system created in the 2000s to prolong the operation of the sarcophagus. It's actually also quite a fascinating piece of engineering, but that's rather a subject for a future episode. Finally, in November 1986, the sarcophagus was completed. It took 206 days and the work by nearly 90,000 people. Inside went incredible 400,000 cubic meters of concrete and 7,000 tons of metal. The builders marked the end of this monumental challenge by signing their names on the final segment installed. On November 30, the state act of commissioning the sarcophagus into operation was signed. However, the Soviet people only learned about this 2 weeks later, when the announcement was published in the state newspaper Pravda on December 14. This day had since been recognized as the day of the Chernobyl liquidators. But the shelter object is far more than just a shell around a destroyed reactor. It is rather a complex technological system, equipped with monitoring devices, ventilation, dust suppression, and much more. These systems underwent significant evolution, and their story is one we'll explore in our future episodes. Until then, check out our Patreon page, because there you can find bonus reading, various archive materials, and insights into Chernobyl as a phenomenon. This episode is a part of a series, so don't forget to check our other documentaries, because we have many, many interesting things to watch. Thank you for joining us, and see you next time in the next episode of Chernobyl Uncharted.